Welcome back to Visceral Music, the music podcast where we talk about tracks we found on Bandcamp, SoundCloud, and that were sent in by submissioners from all over the world. My name is Roland.
And my name is Craig.
And you can take a look after you listen to this episode and decide if some of these songs are ones you want to pick up. You can find them at visceral.music.blog. Excuse me. And you can also email us at visceralmusic@gmail.com. And we have a Twitter feed where you can, you know, find Visceral Music. And of course, you might be watching this on YouTube already, but we have videos up where we review some both contemporary records as well as some classics from the past, like Jermaine Jackson's Dynamite.
I see
what's
you
up, Craig.
Oh, I was going to say, I see you're using the term classic very loosely with that
No. I'm using it in the purest, best definition, or the best way it can be applied possible.
I don't know how that's true, but
I've been listening to Jermaine Jackson's Dynamite so much this week. I'm sure my wife is like, "What the hell? Like, where?" I was on Acid Mother's Temple kick, and now I'm on Jermaine Jackson kick. So, you know, you're just swinging back and forth between styles here.
Yeah, that is a very, very wide swing. Are you listening to it on Spotify or something? Because, you know, you might accidentally give, you know, them the idea that, hey, he's popular again. Let's put out some more music from Jermaine Jackson.
Oh, not only do I hope that happens, and yeah, I'm listening on both vinyl and Spotify, because, you know, when I'm out and about, I gotta listen on Spotify, of course.
Oh, you gotta.
I mean, I hope they do, and I hope I can then take credit for it, that I've, like, re-energized Jermaine Jackson. I mean, he was in that really terrible, like, I'm not sure if it was, like, after Michael Jackson died, and it was, like, his family, like, how do we come to terms with Michael Jackson's death, but there was, like, a reality series about him. It was pretty terrible. It didn't make you like the guy.
Oh. Is he, this dumb question, is he still alive?
Mm-hmm.
Is Michael the only one of, like, the Jackson siblings that's dead?
I believe so. At least there might have been one that died, like, really early on. I don't remember exactly, but all the ones from, like, Jackson 5, and, you know, they're all alive still.
Oh, like Tito?
Oh, yeah. Tito's still alive, fool.
Good for
he
Tito.
He actually put out a solo record. His first solo record he put out, like, just, like, 3 or 4 years ago.
Well, when are you going to record that classic gem?
I have not heard it. Or, it looks like an old man blues record, so I bet it's pretty cool. I'll check it out.
I'm sure it is.
Well, we got some great tracks, though, here that I could definitely say are classics, and some of them that might have to loosely fit that title upon. I think it's an interesting set we got here. It's almost like a... What's the word I'm looking for? I want to feel like, in many ways, it's like a lot of 1980s throwbacks from, like, different corners of the 1980s.
Yeah, I realized that when I was kind of putting together my track list and shuffling in with yours, that it's like, you know... There's a lot of diverse music that came out in the 80s, and all those styles are still relevant today.
Absolutely. So let's actually get to some of these styles. Let's take a listen to our very first track, one that I don't think is much of a throwback, but it's from a London band called HUI, and it's a track called Aloha. Throwback piece with this show, because this one sounds pretty modern. It sounds, you know, I can imagine I'm just walking around London with this in my headphones as I'm getting to work or taking the subway of some type. It just has a lot of kind of found sounds. It's got that cool vibraphone and, you know, interesting beat. It just sounds really smooth, polished, put together. And this is the kind of stuff you can find a lot of on Bandcamp, of someone in their bedroom coming up with a pretty awesome pop song that 20 years ago would have blown people's mind, and now it's like, oh yeah, there's like a million people doing that. What do you think?
Yeah, I liked it. It was, kind of an enjoyable EDM style track. It didn't overdo the computer blips and buzzes and bloops, like a lot of these tracks kind of fall into. And I loved that the beat felt very organic and almost analog. And there's, some interesting progressions through the track. I was surprised that it was so short. What was it, like 4 or 5 minutes or something like that? Because it felt like it could be a lot longer and you wouldn't really get bored with it. It was just a fun little track and much better choice of songs than you usually come up when you pick these types of instrumental tracks. So good for you, you're learning.
No, I just, you're gonna see with some of these later ones that they get into super crazy territory. So, I'm hoping you're ready for that. This was a good way to just get us back into listening to music again, because who could dislike this? I mean, I'm sure my dad and my parents, they'd probably put this on and be like, "All right, that's cool. I don't really listen to hip hop or electronic music, but there's absolutely nothing offensive about it."
Yeah, and it's one of those things where it's not offensive in a good way. Sometimes you get those non-offensive tracks where it's just like kind of a Muzak version of things where it's just supposed to be there, and like that, and that's what's frustrating about it is because it's just so designed to not offend that it's offensive. But yeah, this was actually well done, and like I said, you're off to a good start so far this week, and I hope that I don't have to yell at you later.
Oh, you will. But let's keep this up, HUI from London. I want to hear more of this stuff. But let's take a look at our second track. This is from a New Jersey band called Primitive Lips with a track called Image of Truth. Also, I must note, you sent me all the MP3s, but you didn't send me a Bandcamp link, so I'm going purely based on just what I heard in the song. I didn't see the record covers. I didn't get any materials that you would have posted to your Bandcamp page to give you some sense of this band. You didn't give me any of that, you asshole.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I mean, it's really hard to type in www.bandcamp.com and then search for the names of the bands because they're right there along
It's
with the track
impossible.
title. So I don't even know how you could have figured out anything more about this. But like you're saying, this is a it's a New Jersey band, and baby, they were born to run. Because every band from Jersey is a Bruce Springsteen cover band, right? Even if
Yes, this sounds just like Bruce Springsteen from the
yeah, I mean,
1980s.
it sounds like Bruce Springsteen if
If he lived in Sheffield and liked the Smiths a lot.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I don't think it's a secret, but bands that are doing this whole goth revival thing that's been going on for the last decade and a half are was pretty much my jam, even though, like I've said many times, I don't like a lot of the originators of this style of music. But it's just a tight little pop song that if you like the goth genre, the whole revival aspect of it, you're gonna like this song. There's nothing, it's kind of like the HUI song. It's not offensive, but it's not offensive in a good way because it's a tight, great little song in my opinion.
I'm surprised you put this as goth because I didn't take that at all. I really thought, I mean, I guess a lot of these genres have some bleed in together, but I really heard kind of like a Sarah Records, kind of like 1980s, like, Smith's British pop vibe more than I heard any goth in it.
Well, I hate to break it to you, but what do you think the Smiths are?
You count them as a goth band? Really?
Yeah.
Huh.
They're
Well, maybe I don't know
100%.
what goth means then. Is it just like somewhat sad, or just, I mean, what is then its defining characteristic? I
Well,
always thought it had to be synthesizers, or at least somewhat synthesized, with it, maybe not entirely synthesized, because obviously like The Cure have guitars and all that, and then also the aesthetic had to have kind of a certain look to it, but maybe I'm being unfair to goth.
Well, I think the aesthetics these days plays a lot less of a role. To me, it's more of the beat and kind of that little guitar, those little guitar jangly runs and everything, to me is kind of what puts the goth revival more in line with what's going on today. Like, yeah, there are a lot of bands that do the synthesizer driven stuff, but that almost takes more from like the no wave genre and mixes it with the goth. But to me, like, this is a straight up goth revival band that within 10 seconds you know exactly what the song's going to sound like, because or the rest of the song's going to sound like, because it has the same basic drum beat that most of these tracks have that just works with everything that gets put out with these guys. But yeah, I'm surprised that you wouldn't have pegged this as goth, especially when you named a goth band that it sounds pretty much like.
That is true. I guess I'm just using too restrictive definition. I mean, I've been listening a lot to the Smiths recently, and even some of the more recent Morrissey records. So I guess maybe that just popped out of my mind, and I don't put them as like a goth band, so I that's just where I was coming from. I mean, I'm amazed that there's not more acts from like where I'm from in Southern California, from Mexico, that are basically just ripping off the Smiths. Now I think about it, because I would hear so much freaking Morrissey on the radio, and it always shocked me, because I was just getting into music in the 90s, and then of course here's this, I should say, a little English band, or like, you know, not a huge British pop act, the Smiths, and for some reason they're huge in Mexico, and Morrissey specifically, and I don't quite know why that is, but I'm also unclear as to why I don't hear more Mexican bands just basically like who grew up listening to that. Why aren't they just ripping that off all the time?
I don't know. That'd be an interesting thing to kind of meld, like the mariachi oompa type of polka stuff with this goth thing. Maybe we should send some letters down to bands, you know, across the border, and be like, hey, try this.
Yeah, I wonder if there is like a sub scene, and I haven't found it yet. And there's some like hashtag, or there's some name that they use to describe. I gotta look into that. I'll get someone with better Spanish than I have to help me out with that search.
Like your wife?
Yeah. She doesn't like Morrissey, though, so. Well, yeah, so she'll be subjected to a lot of people trying to be like Morrissey, I suppose.
Well, see, if you find someone that she likes that's trying to be like Morrissey, then you know you got a winner.
That is true. That is true. Speaking of bands that I think kind of sound like other bands, this is one that I think you found from Germany. Let me try to pronounce this. Is it Mega Hair?
Probably. The two A's throws me in hair.
Yes, why would you do that? Anyway, band Mega Hair with the track Sad Night Rider. Talking about a lot of these tracks having kind of an 80s feel, I really felt this one sounds a lot like King Crimson from the 80s, which is a really underrated King Crimson period, because they did some great, great stuff like on Beat and what is it, Discipline. Like those records are really good, but they are kind of put aside for, I think, they're very well-known prog stuff from the 60s. So what do you think of this track, Greg?
Well, it's confusing to me because, like you said, they're a German band, but vocally, it did not sound German to me. I don't know what you got from the vocals, because I listened to a lot of German speakers. I took German in high school, and German doesn't sound like this. You know what I'm saying?
I guess so. I don't know much in the way of German, so I didn't come with any preconceived notion of what the vocalists sound like. It kind of, I mean, this is going to be so lame, but because there's not many German bands that come to my mind off the top of my head, but Kraftwerk, of course, does. And so yeah. I thought, well, this band, you know, kind of fits into that, where it's, you know, it's playing with different kind of rhythms and different kind of synthesized and organic instruments in the way that I mentioned before, like King Crimson in the 1980s did. So I got that kind of vibe from it.
Yeah, and because like the vocals to me, I couldn't make out anything heads or tails, even, you know, the way I expected German to sound when sung. Like it kind of just became another instrument that bounces through like that, the jangly pop bones that make up the rest of the track. And since you're lazy and didn't go to Bandcamp and mm-hmm. just type in Mega Hair and look at the other tracks, I would highly recommend it, because the rest of this little EP is fantastic. Like each track is pretty distinct. I had a tough time kind of coming up with what track I wanted to share from this. And like you're saying with that, with the 80s sensibility, it kind of felt like a great meld between, you know, like the late 70s, early 80s art rock scene, when mm-hmm. it started to meet up with the like the mid 80s noise pop from England. Like it just had that weird kind of twist to it, and like it felt a little dense, even if it wasn't, you know, like a wall of sound type of thing. There's just a lot going on, and like I said, with the vocals kind of popping in and out, it just I don't know. I just really, really dug this track a lot.
Yeah, I like this one a lot too. And this is, again, one of those types of songs where it probably would have been a big hit if it was, or not, maybe not a big hit, but it would have received a lot more attention in kind of art rock, neo-prog circles if it didn't come out today, where I don't know how many fans they have on their Bandcamp page or if anyone's purchased it, but I'm like, this is a good track. This is pretty cool. This is the kind of stuff that people like this type of music, they'd be attracted to. And, you know, I'm afraid they probably don't have many listeners.
No, I doubt it. I never look at to see how many, you know, people like or recommend tracks or artists that, you know, kind of pop up on the Bandcamp pages. Like sometimes you just notice because there's like a wall of pictures of people that have recommended it, and you're like, oh, right. Hot damn, that's awesome. And then there's others where there's like one person, and you're like, oh, that's probably like their friend or like the bass player that has a personal account that just like likes their own band, kind of like how we how we like our own tweets from the Visceral account.
Those are the only people liking them, so someone's got to.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, like there's, like you're saying, like something like this, and I think a lot of the artists that we listen to are one of those things that would have been big, like you're saying, 10, 15 years ago, because like a lot of what we're listening to isn't, it's not brand new by any means. Like there's not a lot, especially these days, there's not a lot that you can do to kind of break the mold musically. And if you do, most of the time it's not going to be good. You know, like it's like the experimental stuff where they're just pushing the envelope to what actually is sound on some level. So like,
but even that's getting, not new. I mean, composers have been doing that for hundreds of years.
Right. But like, you know, an artist like this, like there's obviously certain songs and genres or styles that come of an era that even if they're done today, like we're saying, like there's so many different bands from this set of tracks that are like, oh yeah, they'd fit in great in the 80s. You know, they just kind of took a thing, like, you know, one or two things from different genres and kind of made it anew. Like, but back in the 80s, no one would have done that because, like you had, like I was saying, like the noise pop scene that kind of came in England, they wouldn't have been able to get a lot of like American art house stuff, you know,
true,
just because things didn't travel as well, or, you know, what was on the radio was a lot more local. And so something like this, if it was around back then, probably would have been pretty big, because it would have been like, holy shit, like there's, this is so new. And then today it's like, yeah, well, this is a mixture of these three genres if you know dial it in and just, you know, look at it from a, you know, nerd standpoint. And it's just, it is kind of funny to think about what could have been with a lot of these bands.
And yeah, so congratulations, Mega Hair. If you came 30 years before, you could have had money, but instead you better keep your day job.
What if this is their day job?
Then good for you. Then you're one of the very few artists that can somehow make that work. But I guarantee this next band, this is not their day job. This is from a band called Scout Island with a track called Lonisco Chopina. Label here in California in Los Angeles specifically called Not Fun Records, and they put out a lot of kind of experimental but beat based, or you know, something that's, it's not purely experimental, it is meant to be kind of dance music but maybe a deconstruction of dance music. And I thought this band sounds a lot like stuff that's on their label, and it's a really long track. I think it's about 14 minutes, and there's, you know, just kind of different moments within, and I would say I like every single moment. And you know, I bet most bands, they would have just cut this track up, like, okay, this specific part that sounds like this, we're just gonna make that a song. But we see here that he's put it all together, and it sounds like it flows really well, in my opinion. And I like each one of those movements, that it just sounds like a different type of really fuzzed out, deconstructed, washed out pop jam. So what'd you think of this, Craig?
Yeah, it's kind of funny because I would be in the group that's like, just break this up into different tracks, damn it.
No. You got to keep it all together. It makes it like one piece, and it requires that your listeners, they are being challenged. It's like you're saying, yeah, fuck you, it's 14 minutes. Yeah, no, I know I don't have any fans, but you're still going to have to listen to this 14 minutes. I'm not going to make it easy on you.
Well, like, I'm not upset that the track was 14 minutes long, and I really, really did like this a lot. And, you know, I put this on and I wasn't paying too much attention to it because, like you said, it is kind of like, it does fall in that category of almost background music-ish. But like with each of the musical interlude parts, I found myself kind of nodding and bobbing along with the beat. And then those vocal breakdowns would come in and you're like, and like the music would just drop completely. So it's like there's nothing there but random whatever. And then it would come in with the next track. Well, not next track, but the next musical interlude, basically, the next movement.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'd start back up again, like nodding and bobbing along. I'm like, all right, yeah, this is really good. And like, so that, I guess from that standpoint, knowing it was one track was a little frustrating. Had it been individual tracks, it would have been like, oh, this just flows one right into another. So it is odd to have that as a complaint when you're like, oh, separately this would be great because it would work good, because it works good together, but all together it doesn't work as well because it should be separate.
Yeah,
it's a really dumb complaint. But I did really dig it. And so I guess you're actually doing a lot better than I thought you would with these instrumental tracks. I guess all my complaining the last few months is starting to pay off.
Well, there's still some more ahead here. Well, kind of instrumental, I should say. But with this track, I was thinking to myself, like, it's very washed out. It's very, like, you know, it's hazy. It's, you imagine someone's, you know, doing some kind of psychedelic or whatever. But with kids these days, I know obviously they probably smoke pot because now in California and most other places, it's ubiquitous, it's everywhere.
Yeah, but they're just vaping that shit.
Oh, they're just vaping. That's what I was getting to, is that, is it just now? I mean, I know a lot of students like take like anxiety medication. Does any of that give you a sense of, I mean, would this kind of music work with that type of stuff? I don't do drugs and I don't take medication, so I'm trying to figure out if this type of music is very fitting for the current age with the types of things that kids are experiencing, or is this or does this not match well with, you know, those types of medications, I should say, or just drugs in general?
And it's been a long time since I did those types of things.
But I mean, like, the medication they make for they take for anxiety, does that have any impact on, you know, just the way you interpret music, or is it not really that type of thing? I'm totally ignorant on this front.
Well, so am I, since I don't take those things. But I would imagine it would be helpful. And, you know, just kind of having a track like this, you know, you and I, we've done things in our past. Yeah, like good, fun, safe, legal things, never illegal. but yeah, I think a track like this would fit in with that kind of vibe where you just it's backgroundy enough to not be distracting, but also is present enough to kind of keep your attention when it kind of hits you at the right spots, you know.
Sure.
So it's not something that'll be too jarring or too what's the word I'm looking for,
it's just not going to take you out of your medicated state of anti-anxiety thanks to the terrible world you live around, and you know that it won't shake you from that hazy fog that you've been put in.
Right. Yeah. So it's not going to disrupt anything, but it's still going to trigger some good feelings. There was nothing, like, obviously you and I have listened to electronic or just instrumental music that is dark and loud and very, you know, chaotic and anxiety inducing in a way that this track is the complete opposite of.
Do kids not listen to that then? I mean, this is kids these days, and we're speaking so broadly and generally, but that kind of harsh sound, in this age of every kid is like on Ritalin or some anti-anxiety medication, is that just like that's why they don't like metal, or that's why there's no hardcore punk bands that you see at high schools anymore, because everyone's just too like, man, that's harsh in my buzz, I gotta chill out, dude.
I know there's still gotta be some hardcore young kids aren't there?
I guess has to be, but I mean, I look in the Bay Area, and especially in high schools, like, you know, there's at least the high schools where I'm at, there's no metalheads. There's, you know, no one who's like identified physically, at least their garb, as being, you know, kind of the hardcore, the punk kids. That just seems like that's a thing of the past.
Man, yeah, that's kind of weird to think about. I wonder. Man, yeah.
The world is actually too stressful now that you just need to, you know, sit in your room and vape away.
Yeah, because I was going to say, like, obviously, like, searching on Bandcamp, there's still a shit ton of, like, metal acts out there, but obviously they don't, like, list their ages. It's not like, oh, this is, you know, I'm trying to think of a super metal name, like, you know, Cannibal Death Drop Sting, you know, like Rigor Mortis, yeah. Like all the, I don't know, all, just a stupid band name like that with their ages listed, like, oh, this age 16, so I guess, you know, they might be, yeah, all older people.
And it just might be, I mean, now metal is not, I mean, there's not a lot of, metal has always will sell a decent number of records because there is plenty of metalheads out there, but when we were in high school and the generation before us, there was a lot, like, on the radio, on, you know, MTV. So there was, like, this huge segment of popular culture where, like, oh, yeah, like, these are the cool metal people. I want to be like them. And I don't think you see as many of those, at least in popular music, for various reasons.
Yeah, huh. Hmm. That's interesting. Anyway. I never really thought of that. And you being tied in more to kids these days would have a better understanding of that.
Yep, I'll have to ask these kids these days. Maybe I'll show them this next song. This is a band called Kanena's Band, and it's a track called Escape and Dream. We'll be right back. Craig, you found this one. I know nothing about it, so I'm going to let you start.
I know just as much as you do, because they don't list where they're from.
Awesome.
And the members of the band are Kananis doing guitars, Kananis playing the bass, and Kananis doing the drums. So I don't know
sense.
If it's one person, three people that just go by the same name, if there's siblings of sorts. I have no idea. There's no pictures of anything on them, and I obviously didn't delve too deeply to figure out what this could be. But yeah, it's just it's instrumental rock with like a Neil Young swagger to it. Sometimes, you know, you don't need to be super out there technically, instrumentally wise, to be a good listen. If it kind of reminds you or is reminiscent of stuff you like, it's gonna be something that you like. But yeah, there's simple riffs. It's a little two-track EP. Both songs are pretty distinct while being very similar, which I guess is another thing you can say about our friend Neil Young.
Yeah, well, I must say, I didn't really dig this track. It kind of harshed my 1980s buzz here when I'm, you know, I'm smoking my vape pen and, you know, trying to chillax, and I just heard this one. I thought there's not enough happening for me either. It's perfectly fine, and I actually think it's got to be just one guy doing this in his room. I just wish there was a little more to it. I feel like this is like an early demo of something that could be great later, with maybe a little bit more in the way of instrumentation or a little bit more in the way of experimentation. But I just wasn't digging this.
Yeah, so what you're saying is this is too much 70s Neil Young and not enough trans Neil Young.
That's right, not enough landing on water.
You need some just random like laser sounds through it, just pew, pew.
That always makes everything better. So there you go, kids. Just, you know, put some laser sounds or get a sound bank of like, you know, not on old radio shows, on like talk radio where they used to like have like a fart sound that they just put in there when someone's talking. That's how you make good music.
Ooga.
There you go.
I'm kind of, yeah, I mean, I could definitely see how this would kind of take you out of this string of bands, but this song didn't really fit in with the, you know, our next bank of songs either.
No.
It was just one of those things to me that I liked it. I guess I could have put it at the end of the track list, but I really dug this. I think what you need to do is just listen to it a few hours removed from this track list, and
okay.
I think you'll dig it, because I thought this was going to be a slam dunk for you, because I'm like, oh, this is like a instrumental, like sloppy Neil Young stuff that is just, yeah. It's like post-rock Neil Young.
Yep, and I do like that kind of stuff, but you know, like you said, maybe I just got to remove it from this group of songs and I'll enjoy it more.
Yeah.
Let's take a look at another song that I really like. I'm not entirely sure how to pronounce the name. I think it's OWO16. It's a band from Shanghai with a track called Tiny Explorer. Someone's doing, you know, pop music, and they take the vocalist and they basically just make the vocalist another instrument, and they, you know, synthesize it to such a degree, or they chop it apart to so much that it really is like, it might as well just be synthesizer lines that they're typing out on their keyboard. I really like that. I really like a Japanese pop band called Perfume. I don't know if you're familiar with them. It's, you know, it's a J-pop group. It's, you know, three, you know, pretty singers and they do all the dancing and all that stuff, but the music itself is clearly like, this is producer based, and they're not even trying to hide it. They're not like, well, we're going to do a few tricks to make this person sound better. It's like, no, we're going to just cut apart these vocals. They're going to be so processed that, you know, it just sounds synthetic, but it's really cool. In fact, I kind of like it when the producer's there, where they're like, we're really the ones making this music. The pop star is the vehicle for people to see, and they'll want to, you know, go buy material about them, but they're not really making it. I really like when they just make it so clear in the music, and I thought he did that here as well. So what'd you think of this track?
Yeah, like, this track grew on me quite a bit. You know, it's kind of like a Chinese Ms. John Soda or No Twist. Mm-hmm. You know, like, with those two acts, even though they're basically the same band, same people, whatever. But they're basically, you know, those guys are like, if you feed electropop music, like an AI that just only knows electropop music, and then you just shove it nothing but German references, you get Ms. John Soder, the No Twist. Like, it just sounds German, right?
Sure.
And this is like, you fed that same AI nothing but Chinese references. Like, it just sounds like it's got a nod to, like, the Chinese Eastern music, like a lot of those, you know, kind of the stereotypical sound, like the more traditional sounds. You know, obviously it's not hyper traditional musically or sonically at all, but it has that in its backbone. And like mm-hmm. you said, the vocals, they feel like they are just ripped through a vocoder that no longer records things right.
Yeah.
They, you know, they just kind of drop out randomly. It's great. This was a total sleeper hit for me. And I don't know, like, I feel so weird complimenting, like, all of your tracks this week.
Well, it's
like,
I'm on a roll.
I guess, yeah, a blind squirrel finds like three nuts every once in a while, and you found a lot of big nuts this week.
I always find big nuts, but this is this kind of stuff makes me feel like, man, I really gotta get over to China or spend some more time with people who are living in some of these cities, because I'm sure it's just a crazy, crazy moment with music over there, with just so many people, you know, now having access to this stuff, and, you know, maybe some of the restrictions kind of melting away about, you know, how people can get together and make music, that I'm sure there's just like a wealth of stuff that someday someone will have a documentary about, you know, the 2010 sound from China that kind of developed in a lot of these places, because I bet there's just so much being made that we are just not aware of at all.
Yeah, I mean, and even like you're saying with the internet starting to open up a little bit, like, I just wonder how much, you know, or how many acts there are even familiar with Bandcamp, or, you know, are just getting onto it. Like, because looking through, that's one of the things, like, obviously to find, you know, three or four tracks a week or every episode, you kind of listen to, you know, dozens and dozens and dozens of different bands, because a lot of them are behind like a paywall, and you're like, I don't want to give this person money because I'm broke, and if I did that to everybody, then I'd spend way too much money. I'd be even more broke. Yeah. But like, I rarely see artists from China.
Mm-hmm.
Like, see a ton from Japan, see an oddly large amount from like India, especially like with weird like blues and like metal stuff. That's always kind of fun.
Sure.
I
imagine with India, it's just obviously they had the British connections, so they've been tied into kind of Western music for a lot longer. And I wonder too, actually, I don't know if Bandcamp is readily available in China. I have to look into that, because I know YouTube isn't, and yet I watch some YouTube channels from people in China, so they are obviously working around that restriction somehow.
Yeah, that's a good point. And like, the weirdest thing to me is, I don't know if it's just the genres I look at, but a disturbingly large amount of bands that I find are like from Pennsylvania. And I don't know if it's just a thing where I just noticed it a couple of times, and now whenever I see Pennsylvania, I'm like, oh, it stays with me, even though it might not be as popular as I think it is. But it's just one of those things that always gets to me. I'm like, oh, weird, it's another band from Pennsylvania.
Well, good job, Pennsylvania, I guess.
Yeah.
You know, all that Amish, you know, influence out there making your music great.
Yeah, like that great Weird Ale track.
Absolutely.
Amish Paradise.
And in fact, sorry.
I think we were both going to make a really stupid joke, so let's not do one of those.
Okay.
just talk about again that I hate you because that track was phenomenal.
Very good. And this next track, absolutely no Amish influences. This is from a Japanese band called Happy Pills with a track called Flower. Great way to end the set with this song. I think it also has a bit of that 80s nostalgia going on, although it's a little less clear on this track. I think that this could have easily fit in the 90s, the 2000s. So tell us about this, Craig. What do you know?
Yeah, well, if we think back to the earlier German band where they spelled hair with two A's, this is flower with two R's. Because you gotta flower is a very common word. You got to add something to it if you people want to search for it. That's just standard SEO optimization right there. So
that is smart. And I must say that I'm seeing more of that with a lot of the bands we're finding where I'm trying to pronounce it, but I'm like, I bet this is just a way to get around Google, you know, not having your track pop up.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, Japanese band, you know, shoegaze territory. It's not breaking any new ground sonically. I've talked about this before in earlier episodes, but you don't need to break the mold to be a great track. The vocals, obviously, they add something new just because they are in Japanese. So it's not, you're not really used to hearing a shoegaze band or a shoegaze song with, you know, Japanese vocals, or at least I'm not. It's not like a paint-by-the-numbers sterile recreation of the genre, which we've definitely had before. That is upsetting to me, but it definitely has some emotion behind it. The feel of the recording is beautiful. Like, I don't know how they recorded it, but according to the Bandcamp page, it's just one person doing all of this stuff in their bedroom.
That makes sense.
And this is definitely probably the track I've listened to the most the last few weeks, just because I do the entire little album is nice, and yeah, it's just a nice little subtle twist on a genre that I love. So I just listened to it quite a bit.
Yeah, I dug this track a lot, and I kept thinking when I was listening to it, I'm like, gosh, it sounds hard to sing in Japanese. Not because I don't know Japanese, and obviously that would be hard, but it sounds like he's having to say a lot. There's a lot of syllables to communicate this idea, and I never thought about that until I listened to this track, and then I went and listened to, again, that band I talked about before, Perfume. And it also, it sounds hard on the tongue, like you're just having to articulate a lot more. And maybe it's because in America, we just slur everything out anyway, that it might be challenging to sing in English, but we just take the lazy approach and everything kind of sounds, I don't know, a little washed together.
Yeah, I mean, I guess there's probably something to that when you have a language where intonation is such a big part of what you're actually saying, where you can have, you know, the same word mean, I mean, obviously we have a similar thing where the same word can mean four or five different things, but with them, or with a lot of the languages over there, it's the same word but just pronounced differently. And I guess trying to get that across while singing, that has to be weird or hard to do. And I don't know if they just say, fuck it, I'm gonna pronounce this the way it would go musically or, you know, note wise with the track, and you just have to figure out what version of this I'm actually saying, or if they get the intonation or everything correct, so there's no alternative meanings, or I guess that's would be a fun way to kind of play with different. Just play lyrically or, you know, with that you couldn't really do in English or something like that. So
And it's why, you know, when people do like a direct translation of some anime or whatever, and or a video game, and it's like, what? This sounds so goofy. Or you get a lot of those kind of stereotypical like Japanese to English translations that are totally off. But it really is because, like what you mentioned, that, you know, there's probably a lot more subtlety in it than when you just do a direct pure translation. It's like, oh, that's not actually what is being meant there.
Yeah, or I guess in translation of any literature, poem, novels, like novels or anything like that from foreign languages into English. Like, yeah, you can have four or five different people do translations, and they're all fairly different.
Yep, so hire a good translator. Don't let Google do it for you.
Yeah, exactly. I've been listening to like this philosophy podcast, and they're talking about some of the, you know, the Eastern philosophy, you know, way back in the Wei BC area with you know, this with the rise of the Tao and Confucianism and all those things, where like they don't have a lot of written material about it, but there's like hundreds of different versions of the same stuff that all. That they don't even agree on what they were actually initially saying. So it's kind of like this weird thing where it's like, oh yeah, you know, you can get 10 different translations of the same work and come out of it, and each of them will dramatically differ with what they say that the base of the philosophy is about. So yeah. It's kind of interesting to think, like, even from a vocal standpoint, like lyrically, that something like that can be going on too, which is kind of fun and adds a whole layer of enjoyment that you and I can never get to.
Yeah, understandable. Well, it's a good track. So how about your best in show of these seven tracks? I think we generally like most of it or all of it. So what would you say is the top?
I think I'm going to break the mold and actually choose one of your songs for the first time ever, potentially, and go with the OWO16 or OO16 or however you want to pronounce that, because that, yeah, it was definitely the most intriguing track, the most new, I wouldn't say new sonically thing to hear, but it just, the most interesting twist on a genre that I already enjoy, and yeah, it was one of those things that just so good.
Yeah, well, fair enough. I'm gonna actually go with Scout Island, even though I like that OWO track as well. Just it really kind of tickled my mind. I was listening to it. I was really enjoying that piece. So that was seven awesome tracks. Make sure you go to those Bandcamp pages, check them out, maybe even throw them a dollar or two if you decide to buy some of these tracks. Again, you could always email us at visceralmusic@gmail.com if you want us to play one of your songs and jump right to the front of the line to have us discuss it here on the show. You could find all these tracks at visceral.music.blog. Final comments, Greg?
I was going to start off at the top of the show with this, but I'm now officially a dad.
Oh, yeah. We can talk about that on the next episode.
Yeah, let's do that because I'm fucking tired.
Yeah. Well, welcome to the rest of your life. All right, folks. Have a good one.
Peace.